All right, so they're going to put you through HAM, and if you qualify for HAM, then I'll go through the other criteria here in a second. You know, primary residence, with the two exceptions. First lien originated before 1-1-2009. Not a big hurdle there. Most of the bad liens are before that. Mortgage is in default or default is reasonably foreseeable. What does that mean? A lot of banks, you call them up and say you have to be in default. Well, under the government programs, that's not true. Under the government program, you only have to be, default has to be reasonably foreseeable. What does that mean? Well, I would say that if you have less than 2 months mortgage payments saved up, if you lost your job, I would say that default is reasonably foreseeable. And I would think the bank would think about it the same way. And the banks are requiring you guys to bring in those statements so they know how much money they got in the bank, okay? Here's the biggie, well, not biggie, but here's the next one. Unpaid principal balance on the first is less than $729,750. So that, no high-end properties. Here's the biggie. Borrower's total monthly mortgage has to be more than 31% of their gross on the first, okay? Not on a first and a second, on the first. What does that mean? Gross means before taxes. They don't care about what you do with it after the taxes. They don't care. What they care about is what you're making gross before taxes. If you're paying more than 31% of your gross to the first, you meet that criteria. If you're paying 20% to the first and 20% to the second, you do not meet the criteria. 31% to the first. If you meet all of those criteria that I just read, you do qualify for HAMP, which is the Home Affordable Modification Program. Some investors, though, don't want to give you a modification. This is why I went through the whole thing in the beginning. They don't want to do a modification. They want to do a short sale. The reason why these criteria are on top of each other is because if they don't qualify for the HAMP, I mean, if they qualify for HAMP but the investor doesn't want to use it, if the borrower doesn't want the modification, if the borrower defaults out of HAMP, then HAMP can just step right in. There's no additional requirements, and then pick it up for a short sale under the HAFA program. Okay, that's how it works. So just because you fit all these criteria doesn't mean that you're gonna get a modification at all. It just means that you qualify for the government guidelines. If they don't wanna give you a modification, or you don't want it, or you default out of it, then HAFA will step in and kick in at that point, okay? All right, and this is where the big flow chart comes in handy, and it puts HAFA and HAMP in perspective with the big flow chart, the big long one. All right. Okay. So the next step is here is that you're getting information from your client and he's telling you all you're asking him, well, here's the criteria for half and HAMP. Do you qualify? Not you can ask him, hey, here's the criteria. He may say to you, I don't qualify. It's a vacation rental. I don't qualify. I make $220. You understand at that point that he's not going to qualify or she's not going to qualify, which is good. At that point, you know it's going to be a much faster process than it would be otherwise. Because if your client comes to you and says, I don't know if I qualify or not, I have no clue, but they do qualify, the lender will have to put them through HAMP first before they short sell. And those are the people that are, I would say, the last on your list to hit up for business. And the reason is because those are the people that are going to take the longest to close. Okay? All right. So let's say that the borrower has not gone through the half hour HAMP eligibility yet. What's going to happen is the bank is going to put them through the half hour requirements or the HAMP requirements, and what they'll do is they'll give the once they go through the half hour program, what they'll do is they'll give the borrower what's called a short sale agreement. A short sale agreement is a document specific to this transaction, half a transaction. It's found out in that website that you guys have. What that is an agreement between the borrower and the servicer. But you guys have to sign off on it too. There's a signature line for agents on that short sale agreement. Don't confuse that with the short sale addendum. Okay, so it's not the short sale addendum, it's the short sale agreement, which is a separate document. That is an agreement between the bank and the borrower that tells the borrower, if you go through all these steps and you qualify, we are going to forgive your debt. We are going to give you $3,000 to move out, and we're going to make it a lot faster for you, so you can find, you don't have to be hanging around forever. So that's the agreement that this is being entered into. Part of it is you guys signing off on it, meaning you understand everything. Okay. And when you guys sign off on it, saying that you understand everything, people are going to think that you understand everything, and that's a problem sometimes because HAFA is a complex, timeline-intensive procedure. Okay, and we're going to go through that. basically what happens is after the short sale agreement, by the way, there's a 120-day time limit on the short sale agreement. Once it goes through, you know, there's a window of when you have to get it back to the servicer, which we'll go through in a second, and then there's other documents which kick in. The other thing you need to be careful of as an agent is you have to be able to control that second if they're out there. You guys are doing that now in the short sales, but it becomes a burden on you more under half out because the first will require that the second sign off on their deficiency for it to go through. And that's a problem. A lot of seconds just don't want to do it. And that alone may kick the person out of half out. It's possible. The second will not sign off on their deficiency, meaning that they will not forgive it. If they're reserving their right or whatever, that may kick the borrower out of half out. They won't get the benefits of it. So, all right, let's scroll down again.